is appropriate. Good morning. Welcome to this Unitarian Universalist Coastside Community Sunday Service. I am Laurel Frischman, and along with Bill Hevlin, we are your worship associates for today. A very warm welcome for those of you for the first time, come visiting here for the first time, and for our friends at the UU community of Lake County who have joined us today on Zoom.
Thank you, Laura. I'd like to take a moment to name the victims of the January 24 shootings here in Half Moon Bay. Ai Xiong Jiang, Ginger Liu, Chi Chang Chung, Yuto Bing, Jershan Yu, Marciano Martinez Jimenez, Jose Romero Perez. In addition, Jose's brother Pedro Perez survived but is still being treated in the hospital. Grief can be so hard to express. I'd like to offer this poem by Mary Oliver. Most of Mary Oliver's poems contemplate nature, then pivot to an insight. However, on this topic, grief, the poet turns to absorb the wisdom of another, as if grief is too big for any one person to bear, and that in times of grief, we too must rely on one another. Heavy by Mary Oliver. That time I thought I could not go any closer to grief without dying. I went closer and I did not die. Surely God had his hand in this, as well as friends. Still I bent and my laughter, as the poet said, was nowhere to be found. Then said my friend Daniel, brave even among lions, it's not the weight you carry, but how you carry it. Books, bricks, grief. It's all in the way you embrace it, balance it, carry it when you cannot and would not put it down. So I went practicing. Have you noticed? Have you heard the laughter that comes now and again out of my startled mouth? How I linger to admire, admire, admire the things of this world that are kind and maybe also troubled. Roses in the wind, the sea geese on the steep waves, a love to which there is no reply. The chalice lighting ritual is a ritual that unites us as Unitarian Universalists. Due to fire regulations, this particular chalice glows from battery power. Let us contemplate the connection between today's chalice lighting, mentioning love, justice, and spirit, and today's topic, resilience. Please join me in reading Deepening the Spirit by Cynthia Landrum. We light this chalice, the beacon that calls us to love, to justice, to a deepening of the spirit.
So we're going to try something a little different this morning with our guest speaker's introduction. Often we introduce speakers listing their skills and their awards and their accomplishments. But today, on the topic of resilience, Noreen has requested we introduce her in a different way. Noreen's biggest emotional upset as a child was having a schizophrenic mother who was in and out of a mental institution. Noreen suffered physical and emotional abuse by her stepmother and emotional neglect by her father. She married at age 17 to someone who was 17 years older and who was a binge drinker. After 7 years of marriage, she was asked for a divorce by her husband because he had supposedly gotten another woman pregnant. Noreen was diagnosed with sarcoidosis at age 31. It's an autoimmune disease that has no cure and can lead to a very ugly death. It was at this point she went into an intense period of healing with a new age romp, exploring many modalities of wellness, which expanded into deeper spiritual explorations. She has faced other challenges along the way, but she wanted all to know what qualifies her for her talk today on resilience. We look forward to hearing more of Noreen's resilience-making life journey. Welcome, Noreen.
Make for a different world if we were introduced by what challenges we have faced rather than a list of all our accomplishments. It's what binds us all together. Everyone has suffered at one point in our lives, some far more than others. I have a bad story, but believe me, there's people who have suffered far worse than I have and have not been cushioned by white privilege. We've experienced extraordinary times here on the coast lately. We've weathered through a month of atmospheric river storms causing flooding, mudslides, fallen trees, downed telephone poles, extended electrical outages, and a major sinkhole on Highway 92. These atypical California storms caused great damage to highways, homes, cars, and 22 people lost their lives. Now, that would be just enough to test everyone's resilience, right? But then the unthinkable happened, which is here in our small, safe, friendly Half Moon Bay community. Seven lives were taken by an aggrieved farm worker on January 23rd. I'm not sure if there's a stronger word for resilience, but there's certainly a need for one for what we've all been through at the start of a new year. As the title of my sermon says, I do know a few things about resilience. When I take these online tests, I always score in the highly resilient category. There are many traits which resilient people share, and for the sake of brevity, I'll focus only on five, which includes cultivating a positive mindset, staying mentally flexible, pivoting towards the present, persevering with grit, and fostering social cohesion. I'll also offer some suggestions on how to develop these qualities if you're looking to bolster your own resilience. But before I begin, I want to remind you that the very fact that you are here today, sitting in this room or watching from home, means that you have a genetic evolutionary advantage when it comes to resilience. Take a moment to reflect on all the natural disasters, starvation, plagues, wars, exploitation, persecution, you name it. Your ancestors made it through, dating back to the time of the first hominid fossil records somewhere around 6 million years ago. Don't you find that completely astonishing? Reflecting on how our collective ancestors' resilience has brought you all here today to hear a sermon about resilience. So let me start with cultivating a positive mindset, staying positive during challenging moments. It helps us to bounce back quicker and handle difficulties more easily. And let's face it, not everyone has happy brain chemistry genetic advantages. One practice that can help swing our thinking in a more positive direction is to express daily gratitude. Judaism has a practice called Hakarat HaTov, which calls us to recite 100 blessings each day. That is, to find 100 small, beautiful things in every one of your days. This practice takes us beyond transactional thank yous, encouraging us to be grateful for the small things we might otherwise take for granted. The simple things in life, such as the sight of a beautiful wildflower, the feel of the ocean breeze, the smell of fresh air, the sound of a foghorn. I walk on the coast daily and always speak out loud my appreciation of all the beauty that's around me. And truly, I feel that boost of dopamine. Hakarat HaTov encourages us to find 100 small things per day, such as having good friends, a place to live, food on the table, or just being alive. And even in the darkest times, we can always look for the small things that we are grateful for. So let's say you lose your keys to your car, but you have a car. A starter practice would be to write down these three things, just three things, you are grateful for each evening before you go to sleep. Developing a more positive mindset will increase your resilience in troubling times. I guarantee it. A second trait that promotes resilience is mental flexibility. Flexible thinking provides multiple solutions to any given problem. Sticking only to a plan A and not having a plan B or a plan C can lead to a dead end. Flexible thinking promotes creativity and problem solving, allowing us to adjust to sudden changes and incorporate new information about our plans and ideas, all key factors for resilience. A practice that has helped me be more flexible in my life is by understanding just how different we all are. If you've ever studied personality typologies such as the Enneagram or Myers-Briggs, the mind of an introvert versus an extrovert is very different. To me, that is very Unitarian Universalist, except that there are many different ways of being human. Different personality types offer different priorities, different motivations, and different values. Now, from a religious tradition, a personality typology which explains some basic differences is the Hindu yoga classifications of karma, bhakti, raja, and jnana. Karma yogis focus on social action and service. Bhakti yogis find joy in music and poetry and devotional rituals. Raja yogis pursue the quietude of meditation and self-reflection, and jnana yogis like reading books, attending lectures, and using their intellects for self-enrichment. Just like with UU services, some people only want to hear the sermons And others are inspired by the devotional elements of the music and the art, the ritual and the poetry. And some, rightly so, want an emphasis on how we can do real good in the world with volunteer service and social justice work. So, taking that first step of recognizing such differences helps to soften inflexibility and thinking that there's only one right way to meet a challenge. Open-mindedness and flexible thinking make room for listening to the ideas of others who might think very differently from you. When you are brainstorming with a group on how to solve big problems, it's important to keep in mind our different personality typologies. Now, a third trait which promotes resilience is pivoting towards the present. To meet a current crisis, it's important to have your full attention to the problem at hand. Anxiety disorders are heightened when we ruminate about the past or we worry about the future. When times are really tough, one's problem-solving prowess should not be clouded by past resentments or fear about an unknown future. The Christian notion of forgiveness is a powerful tool to unburden oneself from the past. As my introduction said, I went through periods of extreme loneliness as a child. My parents divorced when I was only 6, and my mother spent most of my childhood in mental institutions. I was placed in boarding schools twice, once at age 12, and again through high school. I'll spare you all the details, but working on forgiving my parents for an imperfect childhood was a huge factor in bringing me into present time. My mother had a brain disease, and there's no doubt that she loved her children in spite of her affliction. My father suffered from PTSD from World War II and escaped many of his demons through workaholism. My stepmother grew up dirt poor, and her bad treatment of me was absolutely better than what I experienced as a child. It took a number of years of therapy to release my resentments against my early caregivers, but it was worth it. It's really quite liberating no longer to be tied to those past hurts. And as for my first husband, there was quite a bit of love in that relationship. He was deeply wounded by his own childhood traumas and took a path that many injured souls chart, which is he turned to drugs and alcohol for his own resilience. And people do some really crazy things when they're addicted to substances. You know, when you turn to recreational drugs and alcohol for resilience, it works in the short term, but then once you become addicted, then it causes really long-term problems, and a lot of people get hurt. So for my first husband, he's been sober for decades now. We communicate once a year and have maintained a distant yet cordial relationship. Actually, he and his partner were quite helpful last year by offering job leads and housing tips when our son and his wife moved to Minneapolis, which is where he lives. A forgiveness practice I picked up along the way was to send positive thoughts daily to anyone that I had trouble forgiving from the past or in the present. As my teacher, Baba Haridas, said, past is past and done is done, but in the present, you are the doer. Our decision-making process will be impaired if we are still triggered by old harms, and worrying about the future is often tied to unresolved issues from the past. Now, if forgiveness is too big of a step for you, You can work on no longer hating the person you resent. Hate is a toxic emotion and squarely keeps us anchored in the past, keeps us from pivoting to the present, where all our attention needs to be to meet a crisis moment. And perhaps one of the most superpowers of forgiveness is learning to forgive ourselves. A fourth important part to resilience is persevering with grit. The first noble truth in the Buddhist tradition is that life contains inevitable, unavoidable suffering. We will all experience pain, sadness, poor health, loneliness, and death, and absolutely some suffer more than others. And during these dark times, we are called upon to persevere until the storms have passed. We are required not to give up before our miracles happen. The main key to perseverance is finding a motivating factor which will propel us through all kinds of obstacles. For some people, that motivating factor might be family or grandchildren, or it could be a social cause, or it could be a community or a goal or a religious belief. Grit is also developed by not tripping over our failures, realizing that all failures provide learning opportunities. It's important to dig deep to find that goal which can take you through the toughest of times. Oftentimes, if our goal is centered only on ourselves, there's no lasting power. For example, Martin Luther King's goal was to end segregation in the South, not just for himself, but for all African Americans. Gandhi's goal was for Indian independence. Mother Teresa's goal was to help the unwanted, the unloved, and the uncared for. When you have a goal which is greater than yourself, what is called a transcendent goal, there's a depth of spirit one taps into which truly can propel us forward in difficult times. Part of persevering with grit is to not give up hope, to continue to try in spite of the obstacles, in spite of the challenges. If our goals are bigger than ourselves, our reserves will run deep. Along with our founder, Nancy Palmer, and all our other co-founders and regular attendees, my current transcendent goal has been to establish a Unitarian Universalist presence on the coast. It's not been all rainbows and unicorns, but I'm here to say that my well runs deep because my goal goes far beyond saving a commute over the hill. We've weathered the pandemic together and continue to produce beautiful services with a talented creative team. We also raise funds twice a year for local nonprofits. And I look forward to the day when we have more people in attendance so we can do even more for our community. A final, and perhaps the most important contributing factor to resilience is fostering social cohesion. We are indeed social creatures. Social cohesion is best attained when our collective hands are extended to the least fortunate among us. Exemplifying this level of generosity is the Muslim tradition of zakah, the third of the five pillars of Islam. Muslims are obligated to share any wealth in excess of their needs with the poor, the needy, the stranded traveler, the widow, the orphan. Only those above the minimum salary are required to donate money to those in need. But if you have an excess of wealth, like you have between $500 to $5,000 extra in your salary to spend, You are obligated to donate 2.5% of your income annually. The notion is, society benefits when no one fails. By sharing our wealth, we bring the lowest up a little more towards the middle. I'm happy to say that for decades, Bill and I have met the standard with our yearly donations to charity. So no matter what trait one has, there will be always times in our lives when we are hit low, have no reserves, and we cannot do it ourselves. We absolutely need a helping hand. This is one of the principal strengths of meeting as a church community, to help one another in need, to provide that hand up when necessary. And I know our Compassionate Caring Committee has stepped up in times of need. And I've personally benefited after knee surgery from the help that I received from this beloved community. We just need to remind ourselves sometimes that it's okay to ask for help. So let me pause and breathe out and express my thanks for each and every one of you. My heart feels such gratitude to you being here today, for your listening to me here today, to each of you from watching from home, to you who have come for the very first time, to all of you who continue to help with UUCC service productions, and to each of you who continue to share your wealth and your time with this beloved community. And last but not least, to my dear husband, Bill, who enriches my life in so many ways, making suggestions and edits in all of my sermons. Today, I have many, many more than 3 or 103 beautiful thoughts to write down before bed because of each and every one of you here today. May it be so. Amen. And now we'll hear a beautiful interlude from both Diedrich and his father, Kai, as they play Ave Maria. Thank you.
Thank you, Diedrich and Kai. It's an incredibly beautiful, beautiful song anyway. Thank you, Noreen, for your lesson-filled sermon today and for the tidbits that we can take back with us to help us become more resilient. Anybody recognize this flower? What is that?
Oxalis.
Oxalis. Yeah, so I was thinking, okay, we need some flowers. Noreen says, well, what's a resilient flower? That's the first thing I thought of. And so I said, well, let me go see if I can gather some. So I went outside last night, and it was raining, and it was cold, and it was getting dark, and I didn't see any. I saw the plant, but I didn't see any flowers. And they close up, and they lay down. So these long stems are actually laying down. And so I picked a couple, and I thought, well, maybe they'll perk up in my kitchen. And I put them in my kitchen, and this morning the sun came out, and the ones in my kitchen started opening up. And so then I went outside and I grabbed a bunch more, which were starting to come up. And so I thought, that's pretty amazing. That's a resilient little, that's probably the most resilient thing we have on the coast. But it closed up, it laid down, it laid low, and protected itself in times of harsh environment. And then when the sun came out, it stood up straight and opened up. And that's resilience. So we can learn something from that little weed, that beautiful little flower. Resilience is something we can practice for ourselves in our daily life to better our own moments. It is the cornerstone of our character to bounce back and keep going. Sometimes we may need help, and sometimes we may meet others who need our help. Giving of our strengths to help each other bounce back and keep going is also a mainstay of our humanity. Putting on such beautiful services and providing this wonderful hall for our gatherings requires some of these strengths, such as money and time. To keep UUCC resilient, your much appreciated donations today allows UUCC to continue to bring to you thoughtful and inspiring presentations such as this one, and to provide a welcoming home for you to retreat to on Sundays here at the Odd Fellows Hall or online. If you cannot contribute financially at this time, one option would be to contribute your time and talent. Please refer to your recent newsletter for ways you can help. At the very bottom, there's a little list of little things that you can do, and we'd love to have your help. We'd appreciate that. If you would like to write a check or donate online, instructions are in today's order of service. There's a basket in the back as well. The gist is to make the check to UUSM San Mateo with the UUCC in the memo field. While these collections take place, Diedrich will play an instrumental version of Lean on Me by the great Bill Withers. Thank you.
Thank you, Dietrich. That was great. We now extinguish our candle flame. Okay. As we read together this chalice lighting, please consider how it relates to today's topic of resilience. Carry the Flame by Reverend Brian Keeley. The chalice is now extinguished, but its light lives on in the minds and hearts and souls of each of you. Carry that flame with you as you leave this place and share it with those you know, with those you love, and most especially with those you have yet to meet. Our closing hymn this morning is Lean on Me, which is 1021 in the UU Teal hymnal. Anyway, this is a hymn by 1021.
And if you would like, if you please stand, if you are comfortable doing so and able, and please join us with the recording for hymn 1021. And take these lyrics seriously. Lean on Me.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Please swallow your pride if I have things you need to buy. Just call me, lean on me, when you're the strong.